Hey, what's up, everybody? It is Dante Fortson here with another great study for you guys. Today, we're going to be talking about Esau. What color was Esau? Was he black? Was he white? Was he red? Was he brown? What color was Esau? And I think this is an important subject because I feel a lot of the times people rush over the information and they are too quick to jump the gun and they are too lacking with sources. So today we're going to get into a bunch of stuff. But before we get to that, today's study is brought to you by the Royal Judah Gold. If you guys don't have your pair, the link will be in the description. The link to the Royal Judah Platinum will also be in the description, and the Judah 2 Onyx. So if you don't have a pair of those, please go grab a pair. Last and certainly not least, today's study is brought to you by Undeniable, full color evidence of black Israelites in the Bible. This is the paperback edition and the hardcover is coming soon. Again, the hardcover is coming soon. As you guys see, 1145 ratings, rated 4.8 out of 5 stars. If you're tired of arguing with people about the evidence, the interpretation, just go ahead and show them the visuals. As you can see, number 5 in History of Ethnic and Tribal Religions, number 8 in Christian Theological Anthropology, and number 10 in Messianic Judaism. This came out in 2019. So yeah, if you guys don't have a copy, go ahead and grab your copy. People are still loving it. All right. If you want to support anything to do with this ministry, the app, the website, Hebrew Sphere, the books, the outreach, which I'm going to tell you guys more about later. If you guys want to support any of that, you can go to patreon.com/Dante Fortson. The patrons got an extra vote. You guys saw the vote. I asked you which study you wanted next. Overwhelmingly on Patreon and on YouTube, everybody voted for Esau. Not everybody, but you know what I mean. Overwhelmingly voted for Esau. And so the Esau study is up next. I've been trying to get you guys the true order of creation for a minute, but you know, people voted for the Esau. So here's the Esau study. And from now on, I'm going to be giving you guys a vote, but patrons will get 2 votes. They can vote once on YouTube and they can vote once on Patreon, no matter what their patron level is. So make sure you guys like, share, subscribe if you haven't done so already. And again, if you want to support, patreon.com/Dante Fortson, #BHITB on Cash App. And when we're live, of course, you can hit the super chat by clicking the S of the dollar sign in the chat. And later on, when they activate super thanks, you can support with super thanks as well. All right. So now we're going to go to Genesis 25. We're not going to rush this. What we're going to do is we're going to take our time and we're going to address as much of this as possible in one sitting. So we're not going to get to Jacob today. I want to do Jacob and Esau. I'm just going to do Esau today because Esau by himself is a lot of study to get through. And I find a lot of things interesting in the Bible, especially when it comes to certain individuals. It seems as if the Most High takes his time on certain individuals in order to debunk things that will be brought up in the future. And I noticed this when I first did my Serpent Seed Debunked book, when a lot of people were falling into the Serpent Seed Deception. And that is the belief that Adam and Eve had sex with Satan in the garden, and Eve became pregnant with both Cain and Abel at the same time, making them twins, but one was the son of Satan and one was the son of Adam. It's a completely convoluted theory based on the misreading of John chapter 8 and other passages, and then the inclusion of false or pseudo Jonathan, that text. And so the reason I'm bringing this up is because Esau is going to be one of those individuals that the Bible takes its time with. And so you have the Cain and Abel story, and Cain, the story is much more detailed. His birth and origin and you know what happened to him is a lot more detailed than Abel. And yet, even though it specifically says that Eve said she got a man of the Lord, they try to twist that into saying that that was really Samael and not the Most High. And then they try to twist the, you know, Adam knew his wife. They try to make that, well, she got pregnant with Abel, but you know, it doesn't work like that. And so when we get to Esau, we see this again, and I'll point some more stuff out to you guys as we go on. But this right here is going to lay the foundation for a lot of other stuff to come. And I'm going to touch on some of those things. I'm going to talk a little bit. No, let me back that up. I'm going to read something about genetics. I'm not going to talk about genetics. I'm not the DNA guy. People are still asking me about DNA. I'm not the DNA guy. I will read from a text, but that's as far as it goes. I would suggest you find people who study DNA and they focus on DNA if you want an accurate answer, because I'm not even going to attempt to answer you when it comes to DNA for those still, you know, sending those messages. All right. So we're going to start here. Genesis chapter 25, verses 19, and we're going to get through 34 today. So 19 through 34, let me go ahead and read these first. Well, we're going to read to verse 25, and then I will address a few things. And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begat Isaac. We went through that history, brief recap. We talked about Noah, his three sons. We read from a source that says Shem was black, Ham was black, Japheth was white. We read from a source that said that the Elamites, who are the sons of Shem, the descendants of Shem, they were a Negroid people, and they passed the Negroid racial trait on to the Jews and the Syrians. Then we just read about Rebekah and Isaac, and Rebekah was a Syrian. Rebekah has a brother named Laban, who Jacob is going to marry his daughters, or his Jacob's cousins, Leah and Rachel, Syrians, who, according to Harry H. Johnston, were passed down the Negroid features from the Elamites. So that's just a quick recap. Now, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel the Syrian of Paddan Aram, the sister of Laban the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah his wife conceived. Now, one thing we'll notice is when we start to go through here, Abraham and Sarah needed to conceive, so the Most High had to intervene. And there we have Isaac and Rebekah, and Rebekah is barren, and she's not supposed to be able to have children, and the Most High intervenes, and she conceives. I believe that there is some kind of link to Mary and the virgin birth, and the fact that she shouldn't have been able to have children until the Most High intercedes, and then she becomes pregnant with Christ. I believe there's a link in there. I'm not 100% sure yet. I have not worked it out. But if anybody else sees a link in there, do me a favor and press one if you think there might be a link in the Old Testament between some of the women being barren and the Most High interceding, and a link between Mary not being able, or she wasn't supposed to be able to give birth because she was a virgin. Press one if you think there's a link. Press two if you don't. There's no right or wrong answer on this. Again, like I said, I'm still working it out. I may be wrong. It may not be a link at all whatsoever. And the children struggled together within her, and she said, if it be so, why am I thus? Or why am I like this? Why is this happening? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. This is going to set a pattern. We kind of already saw this, where Abel's gift was accepted and Cain's gift was not accepted. And so we see a elder versus younger struggle right there. And then we have Cain, who is the elder of Seth. We didn't get into Seth because the Bible doesn't say much about Seth. But you have Cain, who is older than Seth, and yet Seth becomes the chosen line through which Noah comes through. And then all the rest of the earth is overspread because of the flood. And then, you know, you guys know the story. God restarts the earth with Noah and his family, and they are descendants of Seth. So we have that elder younger dynamic. And here it's pointed out. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other, and the elder shall serve the younger. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. All right, so 80 times 3, 60 years old. Now, let me point out that there are misspeaks. I said this before. I think earlier, on an earlier episode, I mentioned 80. That's supposed to be 80. And I think I said 70 years. So if I misspeak, I'll do my best to correct it in the next or an upcoming episode of this. But yeah, sometimes I misspeak. So excuse me if I misspeak, just hit me up in the comments. And, you know, if you hear something that sounds off, just hit me up in the comments and let me know, and I'll clarify if it's meant or not. So yeah, the first comes out red all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. All right, so we're gonna stop right there. Now, the names meant something, as we've already seen with Kedar, where we went, and his name means swarthy or dark, and it refers to his complexion. Now, I think this is where a lot of confusion comes in for a lot of people. This word red right here in relation to Esau. What did he look like? Was Esau a white man? Was Jacob a black man? Did Rebecca have two nations in her womb who looked different based on skin color? And we're gonna thoroughly address this right now. We're not going to get through the whole history of Esau today, because we're taking a journey through the Bible. So I'm laying the foundation for all the patriarchs and all the people we will encounter throughout the rest of Scripture. After we get the foundation, then we'll move on and we'll start to fill in the gaps of the story so that you guys understand exactly who these people are, where they came from, and how all this stuff ties into biblical history and biblical prophecy. And we're going to lead into where we are today. So again, if you have not subscribed, make sure you hit that subscribe button. If you have not hit the thumbs up button, please do so. I know a lot of you guys put the thumbs up in the chat, but I'm talking about the actual thumbs up button on the video, so more people see it on YouTube. All right. So the first thing we're going to look at, do twins have the same DNA? So you have, I'm just learning this, you have three types of twins, but we're going to read this first. This is from miami.edu. This link directly to miami.edu will be in the description, but we only need this part right here. I'm just going to show you guys right here, miami.edu. It is true that identical twins, well, the question was, are identical twins 100% genetically identical? It is true that identical twins share their DNA code with each other. This is because identical twins were formed from the exact same sperm and egg from their father and mother. In contrast, fraternal twins are formed from two different sperm and two different eggs. Usually the egg and sperm come together and create an embryo, which eventually grows into a human baby. However, in the case of identical twins, early in development, this embryo divides into two. This creates two babies rather than one. So based on the description, they don't seem to be identical, Jacob and Esau. They seem to be more fraternal. But then there was something I noticed. And so again, I'm not going to get super far into this, but I noticed this right here from genetics at thetech.org. And so I went there, and this right here, it says identical twins, semi-identical twins, and fraternal twins. And the tech is a Stanford, the university, ran publication, Learn Genetics with Stanford Scientists, weekday mornings in the Biodesign Studio. So this is their program right here. If you guys are interested in genetics, you guys can go check this out. My eyes glaze over once I start reading all these letters for far too long. But for those of you into genetics, it might be a great source. Now, this question right here is interesting, and it's going to address this right here. Identical twins, semi-identical twins, fraternal twins. Now, the link to all these sources will be in the description and in the comments as usual. All right, so we're going to go ahead and read this. Twins. This was written in July 2011. It says, I have a couple of questions. First, what are semi-identical twins? How are they different from identical or fraternal twins? Do they look more fraternal or identical, or are they somewhere in between? Second, how can Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen look so similar but be fraternal twins? Could they perhaps be semi-identical twins? I actually thought Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen were identical twins before reading this. So, learn something new every day. A curious adult from Alberta, Canada, as I mentioned, July 20th, 2011. Now, I find this to be interesting, and if anybody wants to respond to this, if anybody knows about DNA and you want to respond in the comment section, please do so, and please leave sources. If you want to make a video and respond, please do so. Please put sources in the video or in the description or in the comment section. Put the sources somewhere, and then send me a message and let me know you did the video, and also tag me in the video. And what I'll do is I'll check it out, and yeah. Hopefully it'll be in the update when I do Jacob. All right, so now let's read this. This is the response to that question or those questions. Yeah, and this is who wrote it, Antonio Gomez. And there is a disclaimer at the bottom that says Stanford University may not agree with all of, you know, what is written on this site. Great questions. First, everything I have read says that Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen are fraternal twins. Of course, the only way to be completely sure is through a genetic test. But there isn't any reason they wouldn't admit to being identical or semi-identical twins, so I will give them the benefit of the doubt. You probably already know the difference between identical and fraternal twins. Identical twins have 100% of their DNA the same, while fraternal twins share only 50%. But what about semi-identical twins? Well, they have 75% of their DNA the same. Here is how it all works. Now, if anybody can verify or debunk this, again, feel free to put the comments in the comments section or do a video. I'm not the DNA guy, so I'm not telling you, hey, this is 100% on point. I'm just reading. Identical twins start out as a single fertilized egg. At some point very early in development, the fertilized egg splits into two, each half grows into an identical twin. They are identical because both siblings have the same set of DNA from mom and the same set of DNA from dad. Since both sets are the same, they share 100% of their DNA. Fraternal twins are really just siblings who share the same womb. Each starts out as a separate egg fertilized by a separate sperm. They don't share any more DNA than do any two siblings. Siblings normally have 50% of their DNA the same. Semi-identical twins start out from an egg that has been fertilized by two different sperms. Eggs fertilized with two sperms don't usually survive. That's interesting, I didn't know that. But sometimes, well, at least once, they manage to split in a way that results in two people growing up that came from the same egg but different sperm. So there's only one account of this. So semi-identical twins share the same set of mom's DNA, but have a different set of dad's DNA. From mom, they are 50% the same, and from dad, they are 25% the same. Adding them together gives you 75% of the same DNA. I have no clue how that works, but if you guys know, more power to you. Feel free to explain it in the comments for those of us dummies who don't understand the entirety and the complexities of DNA. You might expect semi-identical to look more like the fraternal twins. But we don't really know for sure yet. There's only been one confirmed case of a semi-identical twin, and as you know, some fraternal twins end up looking very similar and others very different. Just look at Mary Kate and Ashley. So Mary Kate and Ashley are fraternal twins that look similar, but they're not 100% identical. Got it. So they're fraternal twins, and you have identical twins who look exactly the same, share the same DNA. Mary Kate and Ashley have 50% the same, and identical twins have 100% the same. Semi-fraternal, let me make sure I got that word right. Semi-identical twins, one egg with two sperms, share 75% of their DNA, but they only have one on record. All right, so let's just read this right here. Recipe for looks, we'll read the rest of this. This is just a brief overview of some DNA stuff for y'all. Again, I'm not the DNA guy. Has anyone ever asked you and your friend, are you related? Do you ever get comments that you and someone else look alike, even though you are totally unrelated? Do you know someone that looks like a famous celebrity? If so, you may be aware that people with different DNA can end up looking pretty similar. even if they aren't related. How is this possible? There are a bunch of reasons. First off, there aren't that many genes that account for looks, so the odds of someone sharing many of them aren't as unlikely as you might think. I didn't know that either. For example, there is a gene called MC1R that accounts for most red hair. Okay, so Esau was red. So it doesn't mean he has this. It says most, it accounts for most red hair. But remember, Esau came out red and hairy like a garment. A garment right there. All right, so we're going to keep reading. All right. MC1R that accounts for most red hair. Some people have a red version and some people don't. You don't have to be a close relative to share red hair with someone. Now this is the first time we've seen a redhead enter the Bible, someone with red hair at all. So I think that's an important note to make on Jacob and Esau right here. And what we're seeing is we're starting to see variations occur with, we didn't get into it too much, but of course, those of you who know about the Book of Enoch, Noah was said to be an albino who did not look like any other human on earth. They thought he was a child of the angels. He was an albino with blue eyes. And then you have Japheth, who's said to be white, which we read the source on that in part one. And now we're seeing Esau introduced, and now he has a red hair variation. All right, so we're starting to see different variations, and people will say, well, the Bible doesn't talk about skin color or this and that. Somehow they think the Bible is above addressing the basic human components, which is just flat out false. So right now it's telling us what color, you know, Esau's hair is in the Bible, but over here we're seeing that there's a gene called MC1R that accounts for most red hair, and you don't have to be a close relative with someone to share red hair. Now do this with a few more genes and you have someone with the same hair and eye color, the same nose and eyebrows, etc. They share many of the same traits because they happen to share the same versions of certain genes. Of course, this is more likely with relatives. Two sisters are more likely to share many of the same genes, gene versions, compared to two unrelated women. Another opportunity for unrelated people to look alike arises when some physical similarities can result from different combinations of DNA. This is especially true for traits that have limited variations but are determined by multiple genes. Take height as an example. Scientists suspect that over 100 different genes contribute to height. That's interesting, didn't know that. Some genes have a big effect and others have a smaller one. And then there are some genes that have the same effect, but there are a finite number of heights. This means that people with very different DNA can end up with the same height. I guess I never even thought about height being determined, you know, genetically as far as being limited. And of course, this brings up, you know what, I'm not even gonna get into the Nephilim or any of that. I'm gonna steer clear of that. But when we get back into it, I'll talk about that. All right. Many other traits act this way too. So people with unrelated DNA can have similar traits. And with twins, we have another similarity, age. Think about how you looked when you were 5 or 8 or 23. Not exactly the same, right? Well, this can be a big part of why people can look similar or different. And this is why fraternal twins often look more similar to each other than do other siblings. 2 5-year-olds look more alike than a 5 and a 10-year-old. This is even true for a 30-year-old and a 45-year-old, even when they share the same DNA. This may be one reason twins can look so similar even when they are fraternal. The take-home message here is that people can look a lot alike even when they don't have the exact same DNA. Part of the reason is that they have certain DNA in common, and another can be outside factors like age. All right, so now we got a little bit of understanding about twins and genetics. I'm not gonna go much further into the twins and the genetics part. So now let's get over here. We're gonna address Genesis 25:25. This is the verse that gets a lot of people caught up. People will say that, let me read it again. And the first came out red all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Esau. So First, let's identify what part of speech this is. For those of you who watched the Revelation chapter 1, part 2, you will instantly know what type of speech or what part of speech this is because of this word right here. And the first came out red all over like a hairy garment. And they called his name Esau. So this word like indicates that it is a simile. So again, a simile, which means it is a comparison. It is not a metaphor. So he came out red all over like a hairy garment. Now, here's why some people get themselves, I believe, in over their head. People want to say that Esau was red, so therefore Esau was white and blushing because he came out red. And they try to make this differentiation between red and ruddy. Again, a differentiation between red and ruddy. But that is a differentiation that cannot be made. I've gone over this before, and I'm going to show you guys why, and I'm going to show you guys a very detailed reason why using mostly scripture. All right, so now we're going to go over here to the Strong's, which was slowing down the computer just a minute ago. I'm not sure what's going on with their website, but we're going to go over here to the Strong's and check that out. All right, so that loaded. It took a second. But this is loaded. So now this is the same verse, Genesis 25:25. You'll notice a few things are different. Instead of garment, we have the word cloak. And instead of red, we have the word ruddy. Why do we have that word there? I thought red and ruddy were different. Let me go ahead and open this. We have the word Admoni. And we see right here in the KJV, came out red all over like a hairy garment. This is Genesis 25:25. 1 Samuel 16:12. Now he was ruddy, and we're going to come back to this. So in one verse it's translated as red, and in another verse it's translated as ruddy. And yet you will have people try to tell you that red and ruddy are two different things. And there's a reason why they do that. They have either been mistaught or they are intentionally misteaching others, and they have an agenda to push. And so this agenda to make Esau the white man leads them to say stuff like red and ruddy are two different things, even though we see right here that the word Admoni is translated as both red and ruddy. And it shows, again, other examples shows ruddy here, and that's in 1 Samuel 16:12. 1 Samuel 17:42, it's translated as ruddy again, but it's translated as red in Genesis 25:25, dealing with Esau right here. NASB translated as red once, ruddy twice. We'll come down to here. Strong's exhaustive means red or ruddy. Admoni from Adam. So this comes from Adam. Reddish of the hair or the complexion. Remember, they try to tell us that, you know, black don't mean black, white don't, well, white always means white to them. Black don't mean black, red or ruddy doesn't mean what it says. Now, I want to show you guys something before we get here. It says, see Hebrew Adam. We'll come right back to that. Now, this one right here, the NAS exhaustive concordance says from the same as Adam, A-D-O-M. So we're going to check this out real quick and then we'll come back. Adam, A-D-O-M. Strong's 119, to be red, from an unused word, to be red, dyed red, red or ruddy. So it's not possible to separate red and ruddy and make them into different things. To be dyed, made red or ruddy, to show blood in the face. Now this is where they run away with it. Flush or turn rosy, and black people can blush. For some reason, people have spread this lie that says black people can't blush. They can. Flush or turn rosy, be dyed, made red or ruddy. Now over here, it shows how it's translated in scripture. In Exodus, dyed red, it's talking about the skins. Dyed red, dyed red, dyed red. So this is more of a verb attached to a color. Though they be red like crimson, they are more ruddy in body. Colored red, made red. So if we're going to interpret this as meaning white, as some people do, then they have to keep it consistent every time this word shows up. And they have to change any time they see it translated as red or ruddy into white. Now here it says, see Adam. Adam. Again, it takes us back to this one, the A-D-O-M, even though it's spelled A-D-A-M. I just wanted you guys to see that. So we're going to see another one right here. So we see Admoni as a translation. And this is going to bring us down to a few things I want to touch on real quick. Some terminology we have in the Black community. Now, this is just a sidebar real quick. So we've heard of people being called dark skin, yellow bone, red bone, caramel, chocolate. You guys know how we do. So right here, I went to the Urban Dictionary. Urban meaning black. We all know that's a code word for black, which is why the urban apologists call themselves that. They are apologists specifically for black people and nobody else, which is why they focus so much on black people. And I find it interesting. They talk about skin doctrine, but their entire name is based on a skin doctrine. The entire term urban apologist itself is skin doctrine. It is specifically apologetics for black people, which is how they identify you without knowing you personally. When they talk about, you know, we can't possibly be connected to the people of the Bible, they're determining that based solely on skin color. If they don't know you personally, they don't know your family history personally, they don't know your genetic history, the only thing they can possibly base that on is your skin color, and there's no other way around it. It says a term used within the black community to describe a person's skin tone that can range from an almond brown to a deep mahogany color. This symbolizes strong African ancestry. So we know this is a term used in our communities. An African-American person having brown, other cultures to dark brown to almost black skin. Other cultures, East Indians, consider themselves to be dark also, which is true. I ran into some East Indians. I think I told you guys that before when she walked up and said, we black people got to stick together. So yeah, you know, they do consider themselves to be dark skin. She actually did say us dark people. She didn't say black people. She said dark people. Now, dark skin white girl, because you know, they always want to tell us black is really a dark skin Caucasian. Now, let's just read what the Urban Dictionary says. A dark skinned, we could replace this with girl or boy. A white girl who takes on the stereotypical personality traits and characteristics of a black girl, including but not limited to use of slang, style of dress, only dating black men, etc., not usually purposefully. So that's just an interesting little thing there. So now, yellow bone. And there's a reason I'm talking about all these. A light-skinned black woman. I'm trying to think if I've ever heard a man referred to as a yellow bone. I don't think so. Now see, a light-skinned or biracial African-American, usually mixed with black and white, formerly called mulattoes. But mulattoes, as we have learned, are not limited to just someone being black and white. Sometimes a mulatto can be different shades of black people mixing together, or black and brown people mixing together. The term mulatto seems to have evolved over time into what the majority of us know to be black and white, but it wasn't always so. And then red bone. This was interesting because there were a lot of things that came up that I didn't realize. I've heard the term before. Light-skinned female slash male mixed with black and another race. She doesn't look full black. She must be a red bone. Now notice how they didn't put specifically white like they did with yellow bone. And there's a reason for that. A specific brown to reddish skinned people of Louisiana with dark eyes and straight frizzy or curly hair, they are often thought of as triracial people of Native American, African, and some form of Eastern or Western European heritage. Red bones are not necessarily Creole or Cajun. They traditionally speak English. I found that to be interesting. That was something I didn't know. So, right here, Beyonce, Halle Berry, Ciara, and Sanaa Lathan are red bones. A female or male of African American descent who is light skinned with red undertones. So that made me start looking. Again, all these links will be in the description. Go ahead and hit the one, or not the one. Yeah. Hit the one. If you were familiar with, if you're familiar with red bone history, and that you, if you knew they were a people, if you had no clue that red bones were an actual people, please go ahead and hit the two. I am a two, a hard two. I had no idea, even though I've heard the term a lot growing up. So, of course, I jumped over to Wikipedia real quick just for a brief overview, because I'm not going to go super deep into red bones. But I am going to just do a quick overview, because some of these terms are going to come up again. Red bone is a term historically used in much of the southern United States to denote a multiracial individual or culture. In Louisiana, it also refers to a specific geographically and ethnically distinct group. And we'll come down here and we'll read we'll read down a little bit. The term has had various meanings according to locality, mostly implying multiracial people. In Louisiana, the red bone cultural group consists mainly of the families of migrants to the state following the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. These individuals may have ancestral ties to the Melungeons. The term red bone became disfavored as it was a pejorative nickname applied by others. However, in the past 30 years, the term has begun to be used as the preferred description for some Creole groups, including the Louisiana red bones. So they need citations for all this, but I'm going to show you guys some stuff. All right, I'm gonna start reading right here. Louisiana red bone cultural group. The Louisiana red bones historically lived in geographically and socially isolated communities in the southwestern Louisiana parishes, ranging from Sabine Parish in the northwest to Rapides Parish near the center of the state, down to Calcasieu Parish in the southwest, including parts of Orange County, Texas, and Newton County, Texas. This area is roughly coextensive with what was once known as the Neutral Ground or Sabine Free State, an area of disputed sovereignty from 1806 to 1821 that was primarily bound on the east by the Calcasieu River and the Sabine River on the west. Most families ancestral to the Louisiana red bones came from South Carolina, where they were at times classified in some census records as other free persons. Although some families came from the southeastern states, a review of newspaper articles, land grants, census records, and other documents referring to the red bones indicates that the main settlement of red bones to southwestern and south central Louisiana and southeastern Texas took place over the course of many years. Although some members of red bone families are noted as settling in the Neutral Ground before 1818, when the land was finally and officially considered part of the United States. The ambiguity of the origins of the members of the red bone community and the cultural attitudes held by those living in the same region as the red bone community, but who were not part of it, is shown in a letter written in 1893 by Albert Rigmaiden, Calcasieu Parish Treasurer, to McDonald Furman, a South Carolinian who conducted private ethnological research. Rigmaiden wrote that he was unable to explain how the name Redbone originated and stated that they are neither white nor black. As well as I can find out, the old ones came from South Carolina many years ago. They are not looked on as being Negroes, Indian, or white people. So they were pretty much unclassified. And so we'll read these last two paragraphs. Historically, members of the Redbone ethnic group lived in three areas. One community lived along 10 Mile Creek in Rapides Parish and Allen Parish. Members of this community were referred to as 10 Milers or as Red Bones. In the 19th century, a second community was along Beerhead Creek in what is now Beauregard Parish. A third community was established in Newton County, Texas, and Orange County, Texas. 19th century newspapers tended to refer to members of this community simply as mulattoes, and the members of the Texas community were not able to vote. So now we have another definition of mulatto. We've seen black and white. We've seen black and black or brown and black. And now we're seeing this could include people who have Native American ancestry, black African ancestry, African ancestry, Native American ancestry, and Eastern or Western European ancestry all mixed into one. So this term mulatto seemed to apply to most mixed race people regardless of skin color. And so again, this is something we learned. It's okay to learn stuff and change your position and you know, adapt your position to fit the data that is becoming available. All right, and we'll read these last two. As I mentioned, historically members, mulattoes and members of the Texas community were not able to vote. In the frontier of southwestern Louisiana, the settlers successfully resisted classification as non-white. In 1837 and 1849, several of the members of the Redbone community were indicted for illegal voting on the charge that they were of color rather than white. The state court found them all not guilty, thus establishing that the Redbone community would be legally considered white in the state of Louisiana. That's interesting. Did not know that bit of history. So let's just look at this real quick. Redbone ethnicity. We'll just, you know, read this right here. Again, these links will be in there. You guys can check it out yourself later. This is academic.com, academic dictionaries and encyclopedias. This right here, I believe, is taken from Wikipedia. So we're not going to read this. Actually, we're not going to read this whole thing. But also, it gives you Melungeons to see Melungeons. So we're gonna skip down to Melungeon. And we're going to look at this real quick. Melungeons are an ethnic group of people to the southeastern United States who descend from European settlers and sub-Saharan African slaves. Historically, the Melungeons were associated with settlements in the Cumberland Gap area of central Appalachia, which includes portions of East Tennessee, Southwest Virginia, and Eastern Kentucky. So these are the Melungeons. And you can see some of them are lighter than others. This one seems to be lighter than these over here. These seem to be darker. And this one looks darker than her, but lighter than these two. So anyway, these are the Melungeons. We're not going to get too deep into the Melungeons. It says triracial describes populations who claim to be of mixed European, African, and Native American ancestry. Although there is no consensus on how many such groups exist, estimates range as high as 200. So you guys can go through read through about the Melungeons if you want to. So I did a little bit more digging, just for you guys who may be interested in, you know, Redbone history. If it ties into your own personal family history, this may be a good place to look. Let me see here. So this is redbonenation.com, Redbones of Louisiana. And so there's some history here, and you guys can get into all this. Redbone Nation, the bookstore, archives, all that. And I'm just going to read the purpose right here. I'm not going to read all that, just the purpose. The purpose of this paper is to pull together the scant writings on the Louisiana Redbones and to present from those materials an account of their arrival in Louisiana, where they settled and how they lived. A definition of Redbones will be offered, and it is hoped that their relationship to the Melungeons of the southeastern United States will be evident. The Melungeons have been called the mystery people, but their mysteriousness pales besides that of the Redbones. In order to properly understand these mystery people, it is necessary to look first at the state into which they came. So we're not going to do all that because we'll get sidetracked from the Esau study. Now, something interesting that comes up when you start to look for Redbone is the Redbone Coonhound. I thought this was interesting. The Redbone Coonhound is an American breed of hunting dog. It may be used to hunt raccoon, deer, bear, boar, cougar, and other large game. It originated in the southern United States and derives from foxhounds brought by immigrants from Scotland. It is characterized by its deep red coat. And so I thought it was interesting that we have a Redbone dog that looks like this. It originated in the southern United States, where you have the term Redbone. I'm leading up to somewhere with this. So yeah, you have that right there. So now, let's talk about adjectives real quick. What is an adjective? A word or phrase naming an attribute added to or grammatically related to a noun to modify or describe it. I'm gonna show you an example of an adjective in a second. So you have the redskin Native American. The term redskin is an adjective. And native, sometimes it's used as a noun, but it's usually used as a slur. And you see Native Americans traditionally depicted as red skinned people, or a brownish reddish skinned people. And a lot of the people were mad about this right here, which I think is very, very racist to refer to these people as redskins. Right there, they call it racism. And yeah, as you can see, they are not happy about these depictions of them. And so you have different classifications for people throughout history. You have black people called black. You have Asians used to be called yellow. And then you have you have the Native Americans used to be called the Redskins. And then you have the traditional Europeans were called gringos and pale faces. So everybody had a skin color associated with them. Even though people want to pretend like this race thing is somewhat new, a lot of this stuff carries way back in history. So yeah, I'm just going to show you guys a few more pictures. I'm not going to go deep into a bunch of commentary. This is black and white. So, or I think that's sepia. I'm not sure, but can't really see too much color in that. But I just wanted to show you guys some pictures of people so you can get an idea of different skin tones. So now let me bring down this right here. We're gonna come back. Let me bring down Genesis 25. Here we go. All right. So right here, Strong's exhaustive for ruddy or red, or red or ruddy, or fully admoni or admoni from Adam, reddish of the hair or the complexion. So what is complexion? And remember, I showed you all those other things for a reason. I didn't just go off on a tangent. I showed you yellow bone, red bone, and dark skin for a reason. And remember, Kedar, one of his was dark skinned. The complexion, the natural color, texture, and appearance of a person's skin, especially of the face. The natural color, texture, and appearance of the person's skin, especially of the face. So you have complexion. When people say it doesn't talk about skin color in the Bible, Strong's exhaustive says this word is used to describe the hair or the complexion. So, I mean, there's not much to argue here. We know that the Bible does address skin color. So now, here we go. We're going to look at Numbers 19 right here. All right. Now this is going to get some people upset. I mean, last time I mentioned this, some people got upset. They were in the comments section, you know, mad at me for even bringing it out, but I'm gonna bring it out again because the truth is the truth. I don't care what doctrine you've been taught. It's possible to be lied to even after you have awakened. People still have their agendas to push and people will not be truthful sometimes. And again, it's important that we lay the groundwork so we know. And this is Numbers 19 verses 1-2. Numbers 19 verses 1-2 we're about to read right now. And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, this is the ordinance of the law which the Lord hath commanded, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring thee a red heifer without spot, wherein is no blemish, and upon which never came yoke. So Esau came out red. And now we see in Numbers 19:2, they are looking for a red heifer. So let's come on over here to the Strong's. Hopefully this thing loads like it's supposed to. Give me a second here. All right, here we go. Finally loaded. All right, so Numbers 19:2. So they're going to bring a red heifer. And we see right here, Israel, that they bring you a red heifer without blemish or defect. I mentioned this before. We didn't mention this in this study, but this word right here is tamim without blemish. And Noah in the flood story is said to be tamim without blemish in the story. All right, I had to refresh that real quick because it was pausing. So back to this red heifer, right? So now we have this word right here, aduma, which says one occurrence. Let's click this. Aduma, red heifer. Strong's 122, and it brings us back to Adam. The same thing it brought us to right here. It says, see Adam, from the same as Adam. So it brought us to 119 from, we go back, 132. And then over here, it brings us to Adam, from the same as Adam, A-D-O-M, red, which is going to be 119, as you guys can see. So these words all have the same root. So now, whatever color you assign to Esau, you must assign to the red heifer. But we see right here, it's translated as red and ruddy. They're translated as the same. Right here, in Kings 3:22, it says ruddy, red of man. We'll come back over here. So you see right here, red, as in the red pottage he's referring to, that red stuff, the red pottage, red heifer in Numbers 19:2, 2 Kings, as red as blood, ruddy, the chiefest. Wherefore art thou ruddy, red horses. So whatever color you're going to assign to this, it has to be consistent with the heifer, the horses, the apparel, and any other time it is used. And so again, if you're going to say Esau is the white man because he's described as red and not ruddy, you're going to run into a problem. So now, Let's keep going. What does a red heifer look like? Since the red heifer is mentioned right here in 19:2, the red heifer. See if I can highlight that. There we go, the red heifer. So what does a red heifer look like? Now, when you Google this, well, when I Googled it, some people say it's different results. You get the Temple Institute or templeinstitute.org. So let's look at who's behind templeinstitute.org. And then we're going to see what they determined a red heifer look like. You have Yitzhak Reuven. Let me close this down. Research department. It says a team of rabbis, scholars, scientists, and other experts in various fields are presently occupied with the study of various temple-related subjects. The results of these studies are published periodically by the Temple Institute. So when you hear people say they're preparing to make the sacrifices, they're preparing for the third temple, they're usually talking about the Temple Institute, and they've been doing this for a very long time. It's not new. They didn't just get ready. People have been talking about this basically since probably the early 2000s, maybe even before then. The conclusions of this research form the basis for the creation of the sacred vessels and priestly garments that are fashioned by the Institute's restoration department, comprised of experts representing a wide range of fields and professions, gold and silversmiths, weavers, gemologists, musicologists, carpenters, painters, graphic artists, architects, and more. These craftsmen prepare their work based on the findings and conclusions presented to them by the scholars of the research department. Once the plans for a vessel or item have been completed, the craftsman or artist sets about the execution of the project accordingly, with his own emphasis on the artistic aspects. So now, they have scholars and researchers and, you know, all the stuff I just read. So what color did they come up with for the red heifer? The same word goes back to Adam, A-D-O-M. The same word, and that word Adam goes back to Adam, A-D-A-M, the man. The same word is translated as both red and ruddy, which means they are the same color. So what color did they get from reading Numbers 19:2 when they saw the red heifer? This is the Temple Institute. This is the color that they came up with that is represented by the word in the Bible. Let me make sure there wasn't no more pictures. This right here is very likely the color of Esau, or very close to it. And he had a slightly, I'm not gonna say slightly, he just had a different color than Jacob. So it was pointed out to us specifically that he had a different color than Jacob. He's described as red. But we're gonna continue. So I went over to YouTube and came over here. And we have red heifer. If you look for red heifer, you get this right here. Red heifer prophecy, Jerusalem's end of days. If you come down here, you see the Temple Institute, Temple Talk Radio, red heifer update. So I pulled that up. And right here, we're met with what they consider to be the red heifer. Let me turn this down just a little. I'm gonna play just a little bit of this. Not much. It says, we'll read this real quick. This is from March 3rd, 2021, last year. Raising a perfect red heifer, fit and kosher to be used for the Torah, requires ashes of the red heifer necessary for achieving the highest level of ritual purity is a challenge. Even a few non-red hairs disqualifies a red heifer candidate. But the Temple Institute is determined to produce the first red heifer ashes in over 2,000 years. This update of the status of our current red heifer candidates was timed to coincide with the Shabbat Parashat Para. Maybe I'm pretty sure I'm pronouncing that wrong. The next to last Sabbath of the month of Adar, on which we read Numbers chapter 19, which details the law of the red, the laws of the red heifer. That's just what I read, right? Numbers chapter 19, verse 2. So we're in the same area. And again, let me show you something real quick. Let me make sure. Let's go down. I want to make sure I got the right. Just want to make sure I didn't miss anything before I go there. Okay, here we go.
Shalom, this is Yitzhak Reuven from the Temple Institute. Today is the first day of March, 2021.
Hold on, this is Yitzhak Reuven. Let me come right here. Yitzhak Reuven. So in the About Us, where's his name at? Yitzhak Reuven, this guy right here. So you know it's the same Temple Institute. Just wanted to verify that. All right, I'm going to let it play.
The first day of March, 2021. It's the 17th of Adar, 5781. And as you can see, I'm standing in front of two. They're kind of hidden at the moment. Two parot adumot, two red heifers that the Temple Institute is raising here in Israel. And I'm giving you an update on their status. The last update was about 7 or 8 months ago. And at the time, we had two red heifers who were getting very close to the age where they could be converted into the ashes of the red heifer, but they had some white hairs which we hope would go away. They didn't, so they are not kosher. Here are other parot, other heifers that are also approaching the right age, and they are 99.9% red, but each one does have a few hairs that aren't red, which makes them pasul, which makes them not kosher in terms of being a red heifer. So again, as we explained last time we spoke, there is a chance that those white hairs could turn into red hairs, and so we just have to wait and see. So we're no closer than we were half a year ago when we last checked up on the cows, but it takes patience, and we have lots of patience. We've been waiting 2,000 years. We'll wait a little bit longer till we get a perfectly red heifer so that we can proceed with preparing the ashes and arriving at a situation where we can actually achieve purity, tahara, purity of the highest level, the level that's needed in order to do the service in the Holy Temple and for the pilgrims to actually arrive and bring their offerings. We're coming very close to Passover, and of course on Passover, everyone in Israel is intended to bring a lamb for the Passover offering and to actually come with the lamb into the temple courtyards. And for that, we need the red heifer in order to achieve the temple purity that is necessary. So once again, Yitzhak Reuven from the Temple Institute here with our red heifers. We'll keep you updated. Thank you so much.
All right, so you have Yitzhak Reuven there with the red heifers. So if those are the colors of the red heifer. If this is the color of the red heifer, and the word being used right here is Adam, if it's the same word, let me go back. If it's the same root word that is used for Esau, then that is very much what Esau looked like. And when we come over here, it says from the same as Adam, A-D-O-M, we are going to see that Adam, A-D-A-M, we saw it back up here. Let me go back up here just to show you guys. In Genesis 25, where we see Ruddy Admonai, and it's going to tell us to see Adam. Give me a second here, A-D-A-O-M, and then down here has it A-D-A-M. So it's very likely that Adam and Esau were the same exact color, and that color was not Caucasian. But let's keep going. I know some of y'all got mad last time I brought that up, but let's keep going. You actually have it mentioned again here. You have David, and he was sent and brought him in. Now, he was ruddy and with all of a beautiful countenance and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. So David was ruddy. And as we saw, ruddy and red were the same word. So the same color that you apply to Esau and the heifer, you have to apply to David. So David was likely close to this color. 1 Samuel 17. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. Now, some people will try to say fair means white, but we know it doesn't mean white, because it would be a contradiction over here to 1 Samuel 16, where it says he was goodly to look upon. He had a beautiful countenance, a beautiful countenance. Fair refers to how good someone looks in the Bible and not to the color of their skin. So when people try to say fair means white, they are 100% wrong. All right, so let's go to Lamentations. We're going to see here. Matter of fact, give me a second here. Lamentations, it talks about the Nazarites. Her Nazarites were purer than snow. They were whiter than milk. So we have purer than snow. We have whiter than milk. They were more ruddy in body than rubies. Their polishing was of sapphire. So we have figurative languages here, but we don't see the word like or as. So these are not similes. And we don't see these things being called snow. Their purity was not called snow. They were not called milk. And it says they were more ruddy in body than rubies. But we are seeing comparisons here. So figurative language is being used. These are adjectives that are being used throughout this. So this is why I brought up adjectives earlier. They are adjectives. So let's read this one more time. Her Nazarites were purer than snow. They were whiter than milk. They were more ruddy in body. So ruddy in body. Let's come back to the Temple Institute. More ruddy in body. So their bodies likely look like this. Let's keep going. Then rubies. We know what color rubies are. Their polishing was of sapphire. Their visage or face or appearance is blacker than coal. It's a comparison. They are not known in the streets. Their skin cleaveth to their bones. It is withered. It has become like a stick. We're going to get more into this later. I don't want to get sidetracked with the Nazarites, but I just want to show you guys something. This ruddy term keeps coming up. So when you see ruddy and when you see red, according to these 1948 people at the Temple Institute, this is what they interpret ruddy and red to look like according to the Bible. My voice is starting to crack just a little bit. I need probably need to take a sip of water while this loads, so give me a second here. All right, so here we go. It came up. Lamentations 4:7. more ruddy in body. Now, if you get into the Nazarites, you'll find out about the Nazarite vow and how it's supposed to relate to purity, which is why they're using the words white here. They are brighter than snow, whiter than milk. You'll get into the purity, which is why it differentiates when it gets to the body part, the reference to their physical body. It says they were more ruddy in body than rubies. So what word do we have here? We have 119, Adamu, and we'll come over here. 119, more ruddy in body, as you can see. And we'll click it, and we're just going to see. And it's going to take us right back to Adam. 119, Adam, to be red. Red, dyed red, same words we already looked at. And dyed red or made red or ruddy. So now this is interesting, flush or turn rosy, which we know it's not how these people interpreted this. It's the same word used for the cow. So if the cow is white and blush, or if the people are white and blushing, then the cow has to be white and blushing too. So we know that the people in body look like this. How do we know? Well, let's go back and read very carefully. They were more ruddy in body than rubies. We're going to get a descriptor here, an adjective. Hold on. So let's look at what raw rubies look like, unpolished rubies, because most of us know them as red. But when you look at raw rubies, natural rubies, these are not white. They are darker. They're not black, but it says they're more ruddy in body than rubies. I'm just showing y'all what they look like. And we're getting all kind of descriptors here. They're more ruddy in body than rubies. So now let's keep going. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though thy sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. So now it's talking about sins, and it says red like crimson. This is a simile because it has the word like or as right here. So they shall be as white as snow, they shall be red like crimson. We're going to focus on the red. Now it says though they be as scarlet, so they gives us two words. They are as scarlet, and he describes them as red like crimson. So let's go here. We're gonna check this in the Strong's again, biblehub.com. if you guys don't have access to this, give me a second here. All right, there we go, we loaded. Now there are a couple things I'm gonna point out here. So now the sins are red like scarlet, red like crimson, and they shall be white as snow. Now, if the people who are trying to use red and ruddy as different words and try to say red, it really means he's the white man and he's blushing, they have to have some explaining to do, because there are some things here that we're going to see. So we're going to see red like crimson, and we'll see right here scarlet. Though your sins be as scarlet, let's look up this word scarlet first. Let's just open that another tab, and we're gonna see what color this is. So scarlet, from an unused word, scarlet. It says crimson, scarlet thread of uncertain derivation. Crimson, properly the insect or its color, also stuff dyed with it. Crimson, scarlet thread. So crimson and scarlet are compared to each other, and it says an insect. This is important. I'm gonna walk y'all through this. I just want to go slow, make sure I don't miss anything. So we looked up scarlet. Now we have the word red here. Let's go ahead and pull this word. Well, hold on, let's just look. What color is scarlet? Scarlet is a bright red color, sometimes with a slightly orange tinge. In the spectrum of visible light and on the traditional color wheel, it is one quarter of the way between red and orange, slightly less orange than vermilion. And you can see the examples here. And again, it's talking about sins, not skin color, but it's giving us examples that these are not white. This right here is very close to what the cow looks like. Very close to the cow's color. We have this described on Amazon as scarlet red cotton. This is described as scarlet. This is a brighter color, which is interesting. But if you see here, scarlet red, we see a consistency. This is the scarlet red color palette, but you see it comes over to here. Scarlet, this is considered to be dark scarlet. None of it is white. Now people can get upset if they want to. Right here, we have dark scarlet. We have scarlet dye. So people could get mad if they want to. I mean, it is what it is. So let's keep going. Crimson right here. So red, let's look at red first. So they're going to be red like crimson. This word red, Yadimu, which is going to take us right back to Adam, to be red. All of these words keep linking to the same thing. And if you notice, none of the examples I'm giving you guys show anything white or Caucasian. So let me close this down and let me close this down. And then red like crimson. And remember, I mentioned the insect before. So now we're going to look at crimson. So crimson right here. Catola or Tola. Worm, scarlet stuff. So crimson, purple, worms. Okay, let's see. Oppressor, that's interesting. And feminine, and feminine, Tolia, this is from the Strong's Exhaustive. A maggot, as voracious, specifically, often with ellipsis, the crimson grub, but used only in the connection of the color from it, and the cloths dyed with it, crimson scarlet worm. So it mentions the crimson grub. Give me a second here. All right, here we go. Here goes the crimson grub, and or the scarlet worm. As you guys can see, I think that might be a tick. But we can. Oh, that's a cartoon. All right, here we go. Look at this. Look at the color here. Passover and the crimson worm. That's a drawing, of course. Oh, look at this. That's just from Facebook profile, so we're not going to count that as actual source. Let me see. Not much pictures. They keep showing gummy worms, but not much, you know, pictures here. Let's see. Worm. Let's click worm. Make sure we get. Here we go. Not sure if those are crimson worms or not, but you can see the color. They're brown, reddish. Oh, right here. Here we go. This is a direct reference to the Bible, the crimson grub. And I'm not sure who this is to put this together, but as you notice, they have that one we looked at. So there's a consensus here. When stuff is correct, there's a consistency of truth to it, and you will continue to see this play out. So now I said, okay, if we're going to look at all these, let's go look at something else that probably gets overlooked in this, the Red Sea. And so I went over to Exodus chapter 15. And in Exodus chapter 15, we're going to see, in fact, let me pull it up to scripture first while this loads. All right, here we go. We're going to read verses 1-5. Exodus chapter 15, verses 1-5. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed graciously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his hosts hath he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. All right. So now this right here, this reference to the Red Sea, this is why it's important to also have a Strong's when you read along. So you can come to a better understanding of the scripture. So the first words that I've showed you have all been related and linked back. But this is an occasion where you will find the word red that is not linked to Adam. And some people point out that this may be a mistranslation. And so we're going to come over here and look at Exodus 4. Why? Because they were cast into the sea and drowned in the Red Sea. So we're going to come over here and we're going to look at this word. Notice it does not look like the other words. It is sup 5488. Hold on, I was tripping again. Let me get this right. Anyway, while we wait for that, 5488, the word is sup or red. Let me hit the refresh button. Here we go. And right here. Reeds or rushes, suf. So it's a completely different word. Probably a foreign origin, reeds or rushes. Red is translated as red 24 times. And right here, reeds, rushes, or weeds. But as you see, it's in the book of Exodus, Numbers, when it refers to the Red Sea. So we see that it's only translated as red when in connection with the Red Sea, but it also means reed or rushes or weeds. So the Reed Sea, the Rushes Sea, or the Sea of Rushes, or the Sea of Weeds. It says flag, Red Sea weed, probably of Egyptian origin, a reed, especially the papyrus, flag, Red Sea weed, compare cuff. Now notice before it told us to go look at Adam. Now it's telling us to, oh wait, when we click it, see Hebrew cuff by ellipsis of yam. Hold on, let me click it one more time just to make sure. So it's sending us right back here. That may be a linking issue, possibly. But let's check out. Oh, you know what? Let's see. That was 5488. And this is 5489. Okay, read. A place near which the law was given. Interesting. So there are two different words. And if we come down here, tell us to see the Hebrew yam. See. So we have the word, or yam, I think it is. Yeah, yam. So we see here that it is a different word used for red when it comes to the Red Sea than is used to describe the physical features of people and animals. That's important to understand the difference. A different word is used to describe the Red Sea than is used to describe people and animals. So now let's get back to Genesis 25. We're going to wrap this up because I don't want this one to be too long. And this is just, again, the foundational work on Esau. And we're going to talk about Esau more after we talk about, well, we'll talk about Esau more in the next study, and then we'll get back to Jacob. So where are we at? Right here. So Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah had Jacob and Esau. It says, and we're verse 27, and we're going to read down to 34. And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter and a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. I'm going to say something controversial in a second. I'm just giving y'all fair warning. I'm going to come back here. And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter and a man of the field, and a man of the field. And Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. One was a field Negro, one was a house Negro. I'm just saying, it says it right here. One was a man of the field, and one was a plain man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. It's possible Jacob was a mama's boy in addition to being a house Negro. I'm just saying. And Jacob sod pottage, and Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. Now, if we come back to Genesis 25:30, and we get over here, this red right here is going to be the same word that we already came across, Adam. You guys can go in the Bible Hub, get on your Strong's, pull this up for yourself. And the word Edom actually means red. Give me a second. I'll pull that up for you. All right. So here we go. You see red. You're going to have Adam. That's 122. It's going to point us back to 119 like it did before. But right here, therefore was his name called Edom. I'll come over here to 123. Now notice that was 122. This is 123. The name of a condiment. Bet y'all didn't know that, did you? Edom was the name of a condiment. Probably that pottage. From the same as Adam, A-D-O-M. We'll come down here. Edom, Edomites, Idumea. Edom, the elder twin brother of Jacob, hence the region Idumea occupied by him. Edom, Edomites, Idumea. So when we come back to the Edomites, you'll know that they're the same people. Edom, Edomites, Idumea. But what does it tell us to do? It says, see Adam, from the same as Adam. 119 to be read. All of these words are linked. The name Edom is linked to the same word as red, which is the color that Esau came out. And it's the same color as the red heifer. And it all links back to Adam. So this is, again, likely the skin color of Adam, likely the skin color of Esau, likely the color of the lentils in the bowl, likely the color of the Nazarites. Maybe not spot on with this, but similar color. Definitely not blushing Caucasians. So let's keep going. We got the field Negroes and the house Negroes. And Jacob's side pottage, and Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. Jacob was an opportunist, trying to take advantage of his older brother. And Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die. And what profit shall this birthright do to me? So this is going to set the stage for the majority of the rest of the Bible concerning the conflict between Jacob and Esau. They each had a parent. You know, they each parent had their favorite son, and they each had a parent that loved them more than the other. But this right here is what's going to initiate the conflict. And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he sware unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. And Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils. And he did eat and drink and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright, or hated his birthright. And Jacob had the birthright. Esau hated the birthright. Jacob had the birthright because Esau sware it to him. The elder shall serve the younger. So let's go over here. What was a birthright? You guys can Google this if you want to. What was a biblical birthright? The birthright, or bekerah, has to do with both position and inheritance. By birthright, the firstborn son inherited the leadership of the family and the judicial authority of his father. Deuteronomy 21:17 states that he was also entitled to a double portion of the paternal inheritance. So now Esau the older was entitled to become head of the family when Isaac died. But now, because he needed food or wanted food, he sold that right to Jacob. So now Jacob becomes head of the family after Isaac dies. And back then it wasn't just, oh, I know I said that when we were kids, but I'm gonna go ahead and, you know, assume the leadership. No, their word actually meant something. So when they swear it, they stood by, or swore on it, they stood by their word. So now Jacob is made head of the family when Isaac dies, and Jacob is entitled to a double portion of what Esau is now going to get. So essentially they switch places. The elder is going to serve the younger, not by force, but because Esau willingly gave up his birthright. And we're going to read more about that in depth later. So now Jacob is put in position to lead the family, and he's going to inherit a double portion. That double portion thing is going to come up, and it's going to be very important throughout the rest of scripture. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to read this here. I don't want to jump into the whole lineage of Esau, because we're going to get into the Dukes next time, and we'll get into all of that stuff. So we'll read just a little bit of this. You Have a Birthright by R. Val Johnston. This is from the Church of Jesus Christ.org. This is Church Magazine. This is Mormons. This is not Israelites saying this. Why am I reading from Mormon documents and other documents? It's because there is a false narrative being pushed out that all the doctrine that we teach is somehow linked to camp doctrine, or this is Israelite doctrine, or, you know, any number of false statements, misleading or deceptive statements are being made. And so it's important to show that there are other people besides Israelite that hold these views, and these people aren't being demonized or called heretics or you know, any of the other terms they use towards us. And they're trying to single it out as if what we're teaching and believing is somehow unique. I was a dispensationalist before I ever said I was an Israelite, and I remain a dispensationalist now. And many people are not dispensationalists. So when they start to claim Israel, the majority of them are turning to dispensationalism, even if they don't know what it's called. And that's a problem for the church, because let me back up a little bit. The church started off dispensationalist, and then over time they moved into this esoteric Gnostic type of teaching, to where everything's a metaphor and everything has to have a meaning other than the plain forward reading of scripture. And you have to spiritualize the text, because they read it from the New Testament interpreting the Old Testament, which doesn't make sense, because if you need the New Testament to interpret the Old Testament, there's no way possible any of the disciples, any of the people that came before the disciples, would have been able to understand the Old Testament, because the New Testament was not written yet. We're also told that the law is our schoolmaster to lead us to Christ. So if the law is the schoolmaster, how do you start in the New Testament to get an understanding of the Old Testament if the Old Testament is the schoolmaster that points you towards the Messiah of the New Testament? This is why I tell people, I believe dispensationalism is the closest view to the truth that the church has. The rest of the views don't make sense. They take a Gnostic and esoteric point of view. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, join any Gnostic or esoteric group. There's an esoteric Christian group, several of them on Facebook. Go in there and look how they interpret the Bible. And you will find that the esoteric Christian group interprets the Bible like a lot of the anti-dispensationalists. And those are people who are against dispensationalism. So now let me just read about the birthright. I'm not telling you to go join Mormonism. I'm not endorsing the Book of Mormon or any of that stuff. I'm just reading to you about the birthright. You may not realize it, but you have a birthright. In the scriptures, birthright usually refers to the right of the son born first in the family to inherit his father's possessions and authority. In ancient Israel, for example, all the sons received some of their father's property, but the firstborn received a double portion and became the leader of the family. With his double portion, this son took care of his mother and sisters and others in the family who could not care for themselves. So now, this explains why Abraham sent all his other sons away. Ishmael and Isaac remained, but Isaac was called his firstborn son. And so Isaac got a bigger portion than all the rest. And so now we get to Jacob and Esau. And even though Esau was the firstborn, Esau sold his birthright in exchange for food. We see this played out in the black community still. And in a second, I'm gonna pose a question when I close this. I'm gonna close a question for y'all. We see this in the black community still. When someone dies, usually, what happens? People sell off their inheritance in order to do what? Go buy more stuff, to basically ball out for a short period of time. They spend up all the money. The money's gone. And then what? They buy a more expensive house. And so that takes away from the time they could be using to build wealth. They buy cars, they go out, they do all sorts of things. But you will see that the spirit that Esau was operating in still functions very much in the black community by selling off those, the basically the birthright, in order to gain temporary fixes. And so this is going to bring us to a controversial question. Told y'all, I'll tie all this stuff back together. Coming back to, where was it at? This right here. Here we go. Identical twins, semi-identical twins, fraternal twins. We know Jacob and Esau were very much probably not identical twins based on the description. So that leaves semi-identical and fraternal. Is it possible that some of the people we're seeing defined as Israelites because they have DNA in common with descendants of the transatlantic slave trade, is it possible that some of them may actually be Esau? Because I know a lot of people like to be politically correct and say, well, they have the same DNA. We know it's not exactly the same, but they have the same markers and, you know, all that stuff. I'm not a DNA guy, but they're saying that those people are Israel just as much as we are Israel. But is it possible that one group is Esau and one group is Israel? I believe we're Israel. Is it possible that one group is Esau and one group is Israel? And the reason that there are genetic similarities is because they come from semi-identical or fraternal twins. Wouldn't it be reasonable to conclude that if fraternal twins share 50% DNA and semi-identical twins share 75% DNA, if you have two lineages of people that exist over time, you would find common or similar DNA or haplogroups? I don't understand how this works. Again, I'm not the DNA guy. Feel free to fill me in on what you think is happening. Why is it that the people over there in the land now, the 1948 people, have DNA similarities to descendants of the transatlantic slave trade? Are we all one people? Or is it a chance that somebody is Esau and somebody is Jacob? So that's the question I'm going to end this with. I want you guys to check that out. Do me a favor, if you enjoyed this presentation, I'll try not to get ahead of myself, but do me a favor, put one in the chat, and also hit the thumbs up button on the video so more people see this. Share this video. And if you didn't enjoy it, go ahead and press 2. Again, more votes are coming. I'm going to be doing the next part of this series. I'm going to get more into the Dukes of Edom and Esau's descendants, so we can get a better understanding of who Esau mixed with and why it is people think that Esau is the white man now. We're going to look at, you know, who Esau married and who those descendants were from those different wives. And we're just going to keep tracing this through the Bible. So if you want to support, go to patreon.com/Dante Fortson. You can support anytime during the week with Cash App on using hashtag BHITB. PayPal link is in the description, and crypto links are in the description. So hope you guys enjoyed. Thank y'all for listening. Thank y'all for watching. And I'll be back with more. With that said, till next time, I'm out.